Okay. Yeah. These are the references that I have given. When the third chapter got over, I have given references from my own autobiography. And there is one chapter in the autobiography which says about how my consciousness was expanded. I'll read a paragraph from top. Srimavatar Babaji ignited the dormant Ichha Shakti, a power of will inside, and seeing my ignited passion to go beyond horizons, he did not deny. To learn from his own holy masters named Swami Kartik or Murugan, Bogar and Agastya, he commissioned me to be their disciple on urgent basis. Vichar Shakti or thought power is very important in expanding our consciousness. They are stalwarts in the fields. They could easily spot us, park in me. My very precious and buried dynamic thoughts, which would have been erased with time in future, were instantly ignited by Holy Masters 3. This is again about Vichar Shakti, but it is just an expansion of what I said, and this paragraph is from my own autobiography which I have written. I have only picked up a few lines in which I am telling you all about how my own dormant willpower was ignited. And to expand my consciousness, my thoughts were I learned about thought power from three great masters. So this is that, and this is a reference to something where I am saying, regarding my special adoration and veneration for my holy teachers and Maharishis, they have told me very revealing facts about creation, God and this world. Example, this is the 13th time that a planet Earth has been rebuilt. 12 times it evolved and perished. Vishwamitra Maharishi got enlightenment of God when Earth was just formed for the first time, and therefore he holds the supreme place in the annals of human evolution and enlightenment. Next was Maharishi Markandeya, and then Swami Kartik in second and third time of slow evolution of Earth subsequently. We need to recalibrate our concept about time, creation, ego and God eventually. This is what you are asking me, what is meant. I'm saying this, we need to recalibrate, because human consciousness or human understanding is obviously very limited. As it is very difficult to even conceive or imagine something which must have happened, say 50,000 years ago or 20,000 years ago. We cannot, our minds are not never trained, or we have never done or never heard anyone talking about things like say it happened 92 years back. I mean 92 is okay, but say 599 years back, something like a huge number, especially in thousands. And as far as our history is concerned, whatever we have documented in our civilization, that much is okay. And it is so difficult for us anyway to even imagine how the earth was formed from one cell. That's the theory we all know. Now, regarding this, the other thing that we are unable to fathom is the slow time involved in evolution. Even the very thought that how the earth was made. And if you go into further details, you'll realize that it was really a very slow process, how life came on earth. And you know, so we get tired, we can't even imagine. We cannot stay there for long, we give ourselves some time. Now, imagine that if supposing we think about all this, we try to understand time and the slow evolution that must have taken for everything to evolve. And starting from that point, if you see today the advancements we have made, it is quite shocking. But the time taken is quite a lot. So, how the earth was formed, how it just started, first of all, nobody knows. And even if whatever we know scientifically, some things have been proved or so-called researched, that itself is very cumbersome and difficult to understand. Now, if we repeat this whole thing and say, imagine this whole earth dissolved and again there was another earth, and in between two earths there was lull, and then you feel like everything has come to a standstill. Now you repeat it again, third time, the same thing, again the earth got dissolved or perished. How much time it must have taken? If it took so long to evolve, that means it has taken a lot of time even to dissolve. Now you take for the fourth time and so on. Now if you do it 13 times, so we have to look at time differently. Correct? That means we have to recalibrate, like how you recalibrate your weighing scale or something, you know, you have to sort of fine tune again everything. And when you do that, because of course it takes little time for, I mean, you people are believing me, but imagine someone who reads this blog or finds out and comes to know that earth was made, and so obviously the first reaction is, God knows how many times we have come here again, or was I in the sixth prithvi and then I've come again? So many things sort of bombard your mind. Correct? So we'll have to rethink about time. And in comparison to that, we are nothing. Like today's time is nothing. You getting my point, no? And we'll also have to redefine ourselves, because we'll also have to recalibrate what is ego. In what are we? Nothing. And if you go back still further, that imagine when 13 times the earth was made, prior to that there was nothing. But there is this power called God who can undo this process so many times. And from nowhere, I don't know how things just again are created. The creation process again starts. And that's what Vishwamitra ji told me so beautifully, that in between two earths, there is a gap, there is shunya period, or we call it void. Because a lot of work has to be done. The seeds of our thoughts, the good ones, are kept, and you know, it's like a nursery or something, or flower bed. So, if we know all this, and then we have so much reverence for God, because there is no way we can actually know how powerful God is. And if you see the prevailing situation, that people are so egoistic, they are so desirous of something, they never understand that this is just a game, or a maze, or everything is so temporary, and they take things so seriously, they have such solid ego inside them, and for something they'll feel so touchy, like out of nowhere they'll feel so bad, and then you wonder, what is all this, where is, or if you look at yourself, then you feel that how can we ever be proud, how can we be so how can we have ego? An ego of what? So, and one, the third was the recalibrate our concept about time, creation, ego and God. So all these things are interrelated, that eventually you see that, my God, this creation, the power of creation is so great, God is so great, and in comparison, what am I? And Like we say, who am I in this world? There's millions, billions of people. I'm nobody. Correct. And imagine, who are we in front of God then? Our power is what? So when we understand that God has such magnanimous powers, humongous powers, we start suddenly our concepts about ourselves, what we have been thinking about ourselves, the importance of I, me, mine, suddenly changes, and something just sheds, something just drops off. So this is what is meant by recalibrate. This is actually, I think, from Vishwamitraji's post, where I have quoted a portion of that. That the very thought that this sage was there when the first earth, when I came to know it, I only prostrated at him. Because we do not know what kind of earth or what situation was there, because we are in present times, and we imagine previous times as this time only, but it was not so. The development of our brain or our bodies is very different from what they were previously. So much changes, so many changes have happened. Correct? So, I mean, when you look back, when God gives or God has given us today the power to go back so much behind in time. So this brings in lot of calmness inside, lots of gratitude, and basically lot of stillness. Thehrav, jisko bolte hai na, bahut aayega aapko ye soch ke. And imagine at that time we can't even visualize what kind of prithvi it was, and itna faded, itna, like we can't push our mind beyond the limit. And at that time Vishwamitraji must have worked so hard on himself, and in that time and era he was able to extricate himself from this maya, and he knew God, and he had a brilliant enlightenment. Why these names are shining today, the names where we have made these epics and things like that? Because these rishis, the prominent one, there were others also who got enlightenment. It's not that others didn't. But they are the ones who were first, number one, they were first. Secondly, when they were first, their enlightenment was very brilliant. We have degrees. We have done the same thing here, if you remember, in Boganathaji's post, that enlightenment also has degrees. Supposing this room was very dark when we entered, there was a lot of darkness here. So if we light a candle, we'll say there is light inside. Because we are comparing it to the previous darkness. Then forget that candle. If you light one lamp, 60, 40 watts, you'll say there is light. And then, you know, this goes on. So everything is called light. But there is more light in the later stages, what I'm describing. But we call it enlightenment only, also. I mean, only enlightenment. We can't say, there are no names, there are no definitions of grade A, grade B, or 1, 2, 3. We don't have grades. At the most, you could grade them so-called by names of samadhis and all. But the kind of enlightenment or illumination maharishis, these our gurus have, they're beyond samadhi. Samadhi is a very, I mean, ultimately you feel these are jargons. What are these? Because their state is, because they have touched the depth, greatest depths of silence, greatest depths of peace, stillness. It's only a limit, that a limited thing that has been described in the scriptures. They are beyond scriptures. So we have to recalibrate because we are depending on scriptures. Unless this method is adopted, the direct communion or the direct transference method, you'll depend on books only. But the books, most of the scriptures were again through mental communication, the genuine books. So we are talking today things like beyond scriptures. What is beyond moksha? Beyond. Everything is beyond. Beyond anant. Beyond infinity. So these things are about beyond infinity. That imagine somebody came when the earth was just formed for the first time. And since then he is in tapas. Can you fathom the time? We can't fathom. We have no words to describe. And if we describe too much, we will lose the essence. I mean, we can describe. There will be someone who will be very intellectual. But we just have to grasp what I'm saying. Right? So I think it's understood now, right? So we today also, otherwise also we'll have to recalibrate our thinking. Na? What we think about ourselves now is very different from what we thought about ourselves. Like in Hindi we say, main hoon, I'm there. How important it was earlier, I am there. Now that everything is dissolving. Any other question?
After your surgery, something you have memory loss that time. Then how you recover this memory and how much time it took? Because I am also observing this one, I am also forgetting after my surgery certain things. After my 2017, after 2017. So how you recovered from that?
I was very determined that I have to get it back. I think he was not there. Yeah.
Ma.
The first thing was, I made my timetable. His question is, when I have referred, I have mentioned, narrated my story in very brief. I mean, Maharishi is telling, I didn't tell you people, but Maharishi Markandeya is giving an example of me.
Yes.
That imagine somebody losing a part of the memory because of some surgical procedure. And in a time span of just 13 years, probably the brain has developed, I have no idea, maybe 10 times, 20 times, 40 times, 50 times, it could be 100 times. I don't even know, someone has to tell me. But a miracle has happened. Somebody should do thesis on this. The reason is, my brain is so large today. It has so much information, there's so much data inside. And it is very neatly packed. You remember we did this here in Rishikesh, that the brain is like a cubicle and we are like how we have small drawers or cubicles and then we put one small item in each cubicle. If we store our information, gathered information in our brain in an organized manner, we will really have lots of information, we'll have space. Now I'll go back to your question. That how did I do it? How did I regain my memory? I did a lot of hard work. I only did mental and physical exercise. But in 2 months I started recovering, in 3 months maximum. But I took another 3 or 4 months, total 6 months you could say. I did physical exercise, mental exercise without fail. It was like a Gayatri mantra or some jap I used to do. I would should I continue?
Yes.
Okay. And I ate special kind of foods which are good for brains. There are some foods which are very good for brains, like coconut water, of course walnuts, and say even seeds like pumpkin seeds, they have magnesium. zinc, almonds, of course, that's a very well known traditional thing. So brain foods are very good, and even milk for that matter, and lots of salads, raw things, because they have a lot of prana. And for any otherwise also for brain activities, if you are using, especially when you are regrowing yourself for your growth, when we are in that phase of rapid development, we must eat lot of raw things, salads and fruits, because they have lots of minerals and vitamins. So regeneration of brain is done by specific type of foods. And apart from that, we definitely have Brahmi, we have Ashwagandha. They are excellent, good for rebuilding neurons, the nerve cells. And there must be some more Ayurvedic medicines. Basically, some Ayurvedic medicines are good. And lots of intake of prana. That time I didn't do too much yoga, but doing pranayama is really going to help you, because there are specific exercises which are meant. Otherwise also, if you do inverted asanas, you know, where you bend your head down, you will give lot of oxygen to your brain. And one of the most crucial thing in regenerating your brain is taking sufficient sleep. Sleep will really recharge, I mean regenerate your cells. And we normally cut down our sleep. 7 to 8 hours, 7 hours. For adults, 7 is okay, 8 is for youngsters. But minimum 7 hours. And 7 hours in continuity. Not 3 days you take 7 hours, then you go back to your 5 hours and 4 hours. Don't do that. If you give lots of rest to your brain, and the other is applying your will. If you start applying your will and mentally give affirmations and say positive things to you. And I remember I used to tell myself that I'm getting better, I'm getting better. And I actually saw how the cells were regenerating. My intuition showed me everything. So my knowledge is very it's my own experience actually. So all these things are going to help. And do some brisk walking. Brisk walking will give you a lot of like a gush of oxygen. And this is what Shivananji tells me a lot, and I would give everyone the prasad, you could say, because we don't give prasad in satsang. So I feel like giving, because we are here in his ashram. I feel I'm sitting in his ashram, not here. So one of the secrets the yogis tell me, and since I feel like giving you something today from my side, the secret to good living or a long, happy, healthy life and body is, that's the reason why God actually made yoga, Patanjali yoga and all that. That if we somehow make the blood flow in every nook and corner of a body, we'll not have ailments. It's only when there is some stoppage of blood and life force that we start getting diseases. So exercise, that's why, is very important. We should not be just sitting and listening. Make your body very frisky.
Very small question. Is there any special process to go the rishis, or just like normally
No, you just sit, be natural. Don't try to achieve something. What is happening is that Since the evening session stretched, I didn't want to stretch it too far. I mean, I didn't want it to be so long, so we just finished it. But I wanted to tell you in the evening also that what you're doing is actually hatha yoga. Hatha yoga involves a lot of your hat means zid or something, and it also involves a lot of ego. So you may be able to do a few things, you may be able to achieve something, but it is not healthy, it is not good, because the ego has to be removed. But if the whole tapasya or sadhana is done with ego, it's going to cause you harm. So whatever you say, I feel that you're trying to achieve something. We are not here to achieve anything. I'm telling you the opposite things. What you know and what you should now unlearn. God realization comes only when we unlearn everything. It's like forgetfulness. Kis tarah ka vismriti. अपने आप को भूल जाइए आप कौन है. ओनली देन विल बी रियली काम. सो आई वुड सजेस्ट दैट यू बिकम अ स्मॉल होली चाइल्ड. बी अ बेबी इन मदर्स आर्म्स. बोलते ना बेबी उठाया बच्चे, बच्चे को फिक्र नहीं है. अ बेबी इज नेवर वरीड व्हेन विल आई गेट फूड, व्हाट विल हैपन टू मी, हु इज गोइंग टू टेक केयर ऑफ मी. So think that father is, God is our holy father, mother, whatever you can perceive, whatever you like. And then surrender yourself completely. Tell God, I am a small child, I know nothing. Start saying that. And beyond a certain point, there is no need to know so much, because you will never be able to grasp or gather. There is so much God has given, there is so much this world has written. Even spiritual knowledge is endless. But Atma Sakshatkar or knowing God is different. So remove this idea from your mind that because it gives you a high. And that's a trap for any sadhak or yogi. It gives you a thrill. Because somehow we feel that we can do something, we have some kind of control over things. Sab chhod do. And masoom bachcha banke baitho, Bhagwan apne aap sab karenge, jo bhi karna hai, jo aap chahte ho. And don't think that if I attain something, I'll be able to solve a few problems. Maybe humans want that. We can't tackle problems, so we think we should have some energies, special faculties, special yogic shakti, and then I'll be able to do that. Don't do that. Wo mat karo. Ye to avdhut bhi karte hain, ye jo Ghori Baba, or what are they doing? Achha nahi hai. In the long run, bahut bahut khatarnak hai ye. Ye khel hai. Because पावर्स इतनी आने के बाद बहुत गड़बड़ है. सो वी हैव टू बी केयरफुल. एंड व्हेन टाइम कम्स, व्हेन गॉड वांट्स, यू विल यूज. इट्स लाइक सपोजिंग, आई मीन आई डोंट नो हाउ टू टेल यू, बट से लाइक हाउ वी गो टू द बैंक टू विड्रॉ मनी, द पर्सन और द टेलर वॉट एवर, हाउ दे शेल आउट मनी. They never feel it's there. There may be lakhs of rupees. They're just distributing money to so many people. So in the same way, we should think that everything is of God. We are here just a medium. And whatever has to be done through me. And if God wants to give me some powers, they will come. And I shall not be interested in power. ये खतरनाक खेल है, इसमें मत घुसो. जानो भी मत लोगों के पास क्या शक्ति है, क्या हो रहा है, हमारा क्या मतलब है. सो इट्स लाइक घर के अंदर खेलोगे सेफ है, घर के बाहर जाओगे कुछ भी होता है. सो एक सेफ एरिया में रहो एंड गुरु की प्रोटेक्टेड ऑरा में रहो, तब तो ठीक है. अपने आप जाके खेलोगे दुनिया में तो बहुत गड़बड़ है, डेंजर है, बहुत डेंजर है. क्योंकि ये एक टाइम नहीं, बहुत जन्मों में गड़बड़ चलता है, फिर बहुत मुश्किल है इसमें से निकलना. बिकॉज आई नो सो मेनी पीपल जिनका अभी कोई इलाज नहीं है, बहुत लंबा उनका भोग शुरू होता है. सो भगवान की शक्ति से मत खेलो, भगवान से प्यार करो. बहुत डेंजरस गेम्स हैं ये, जो लोग बताते हैं ना ऐसा ऐसा, वो सब नहीं करो. जस्ट बी इनोसेंट, सिन फ्री, छोटा सा भोला भाला बच्चा. बाकी भगवान से सब होता है. एंड अगर भगवान कुछ देता भी है तो वो भगवान की अमानत है और सबके लिए यूज़ कर लो. अब ये बात तो मुझे भृगु महाराज ने बोली थी, शायद कभी किसी को बोलनी नहीं थी, पर मुझे आज तुम पे सब पे प्यार आया. मैंने कहा मैं कुछ देती नहीं, बच्चे आ गए, प्रसाद भी नहीं देती, चलो दे देते हैं. बता दो इनको कि योग का एक्चुअली ये सारे योगासन हम क्यों करते हैं. बिकॉज आई हैव रिटन समवेयर ना, या नहीं लिखा है तो लिखूंगी. वी वर टॉकिंग ओनली ऑफ थॉट, थॉट पावर, राइट. भृगु महर्षि वॉज द वन हु न्यू, हु गॉट योग, योगा फ्रॉम गॉड फर्स्ट, एंड देन ही मेंटली ट्रांसफर्ड ऑल ऑफ इट टू पतंजलि, एंड पतंजलि रिकॉर्डेड इट. सो वी ओनली नो अप टिल पतंजलि. देर इज नो वन ग्रेटर देन भृगु इन योगासन एंड एवरीथिंग, बट पीपल हैव अडल्ट्रेटेड इट लेटर ऑन बाय पुटिंग हठ योग एंड ऑल. Because with Hatha Yoga they want to arouse their Kundalini, and they do it because they want Shakti. But no one tells you the right thing, that there is always some negative force which will hover around these Shaktis, and you won't be able to handle those negative Asuric Shakti. We only want Shakti, but we don't know that there is Asuric Shakti around that Devic Shakti. Don't tamper with all that. Chhod do usko. Anybody?
I don't know whether it's a right hand question, but we have rishis, sapta rishis, and no women rishis at all?
No, we have.
We have.
We have. We definitely have.
Not heard of them.
No, she's saying, why do we only have male rishis? Why don't we have... But the thing is that since I became a recipient with God's grace to attain the highest spiritual knowledge, this is achievable only from the highest seers, and they're all males. Like I said, there are categories. Even Markandeya Maharishi said, "Na, that I am the first woman who has become his recipient as an external drive." And for many rishis, I am the only lady. Because so far, no lady has come this far. It's very difficult. Yeah. Let's not say that, oh, I am the only one. No, no. I don't know how I came up till here.